Good evening to everyone and welcome to today's session. Today, we shall make a start of neuroanatomy. For the next 5 days, we are going to have end-to-end, a complete discussion on all the high-yield issues in neuroanatomy. If you take the NEET PG exam, out of 20 questions, a minimum 5 to 6 questions come from neuroanatomy. Then probably another 8 to 10 from the gross anatomy and 2 to 3 questions in embryology and 2 to 3 in histology. So that's the reason we shall invest about 5 days of our time into the topic of neuroanatomy. We welcome our Jabalpur had an issue with the audio. Just help us. Audio. Low voice. Manu is saying low voice. No, just check the voice settings. No? Here, okay. But Manu is also clear, clear. Murali is saying clear, all right. Probably, yeah. So it is clear, all right. Come out of it. So we welcome our online students from Raipur, Rohit, and also from the Jabalpur Center. I am very happy to see the students of MP after a long period of time. And Manu, etc., etc. Now, we shall discuss the gross anatomy of the brain and the spinal cord. The brain, what is the weight? Less than a half kg. Thank God. There is no research which has said that fatter the person, heavier the brain. If there would have been any correlation, people would have been spent a lot of time in eating rather than going to coaching. So, the brain, whether you are a topper in NEET PG or whether you are a loser, is 350 grams only, doctor, unless you get a brain tumor. In the case of the newborn, alright. So 1400 grams, nearly 1.5 kg in the case of the adult. Now, the brain has got about 6 post-embryonic structures. Post-embryonic structures, telencephalon, diencephalon, mesencephalon, pons medulla oblongata, and cerebellum is the typical classification. Now, what is telencephalon? Let's talk about it. Typically, it contains cerebral hemispheres and the basal ganglia. The cerebral hemispheres contain the lateral ventricles. You know very well. And the cerebral hemispheres have got about 6 lobes and the olfactory structures. One of the common questions asked is, in which lobe, which particular sensory area is located, is one of the favorite MCQ in the exam. Now, frontal lobe, what are the important structures that we need to basically remember, doctor? Yes. The frontal lobe has got a precentral gyrus. You have got a central sulcus and a precentral gyrus. Precentral gyrus, motor cortex, area 4. They are the buzzwords which you need to basically remember. One of the favorite question of the examiner. Then, there is a superior frontal gyrus which contains the supplementary motor cortex on the medial surface, which is called as the area 6. The number 6 should not be basically forgotten. Then, middle frontal gyrus, it contains the frontal eye field, area 8. Lot of exams questions was asked. Conjugate gaze is there, no? Who controls the conjugate gaze of our eyes? Where is the center located? Your confident answer is frontal lobe is what you need to remember. It is the area 8 is what I want to underscore to all of you. Then, Broca's area, which is a most important speech area in a dominant hemisphere. If I am a right-handed guy, then my left cerebral hemisphere will have Broca's. If I am a left-handed guy, then my right hand will have the Broca's. So, inferior frontal gyrus contains Broca's area in the dominant hemisphere, area 44 and 45 is what need to be remembered. Then we have the gyrus rectus and orbital gyri, once more in the frontal lobe, which are separated by the olfactory sinus. They are not that important. But what is very important in the frontal lobe once more is the paracentral lobule. See, you have a superior frontal gyrus and here you are having a precentral area. Right? Motor area. Between the two you have what is called as the anterior paracentral lobule on the medial surface. What is the importance of this paracentral lobule, doctor? It is specially supplied by anterocerebral artery. And typically, the contralateral lower limb movements are controlled by the paracentral lobule. That's the reason whenever there is an anterocerebral artery occlusion, then there is a monoparesis of only the lower limb. No hemiplegia, no quadriplegia, but monoparesis of the contralateral lower limb is what you get whenever there is an anterocerebral artery occlusion. Hence, you need to remember. Then what is the significance of parietal lobe? The precentral gyrus is there in the frontal lobe, but postcentral gyrus, which is all our sensory system, from thalamus, all the sensations are relayed to this area, which is the postcentral gyrus, which is called as the primary somatosensory area of the cerebral cortex. Area 1, area 2, area 3 are the three areas which need to be basically remembered. Then, we have a superior parietal lobule, as what you can see, once more in the parietal lobe. This is a typical area, classically called the somatosensory association area. You have one main sensory cortex, other is sensory association cortex, which is typically located once more in parietal lobule, in the superior parietal lobule, is what need to be remembered. Then, in the parietal lobe, we have a supramarginal gyrus. What is the importance of it? Bura mat dekho, bura mat bolo, bura mat socho. Right? So, the three monkeys of Gandhiji. So, what we hear, what we see, what we feel, all the three become coordinated in the supramarginal gyrus. Hence, it has got a great significance. Area 40 is very, very important for the parietal lobe. So, that is the reason, if somebody had a parietal lobular lesion, how will you clinically test it as a neurologist, doctor? You will make him to close the eyes and you will put one coin in his hand and ask, what is this? So, between our vision, our sensory and our audition, all the three, to correlate the information, it happens in the supramarginal gyrus is what you have to basically remember. That's all the story of parietal lobe. Summarize, doctor, we have supramarginal gyrus, we have a superior parietal lobule, And a post-central gyrus, which is the primary somatosensory area. These are the three areas to be remembered in relationship with parietal lobe is what you need to basically remember. Now, coming to the temporal lobe. In the temporal lobe, we have what is called transverse temporal gyri of Haeckel, which is the primary auditory area. Lot of exams, this is a favorite question of the examiner. Primary auditory cortex, where is it located? You need to remember area 41 and 42, which is typically called transverse temporal gyri of Haeckel, in which you have the primary auditory cortex is what I want to underscore. Then, in the temporal area, we have a superior temporal gyrus. Just like inferior frontal area, you have Broca's in the frontal lobe. In the temporal lobe, in the superior temporal gyrus, we have the Wernicke's speech area in the dominant hemisphere, which is called area 22. So, what is the significance of this? It is the area where we will be able to have a comprehension. If a professor is delivering a lecture, we are able to understand it. Irrespective of the professor's ability to make you understand. What is the first criteria? Your Wernicke's must be good enough to understand what professor is blabbering. Right? So that is a function of Wernicke's. Then comes the occipital lobe on which a lot of questions come. Occipital lobe contains cuneus, which has got the visual cortex, area 17, 18 and 19. And there is a lingual gyrus which is also important for the visual cortex and the insular lobe. So mainly visual cortex, occipital lobe, you are not going to fundamentally forget. Then we said six lobes. Occipital, frontal, temporal, parietal, ho gaya na, aur do hai. One is limbic lobe. What is limbic lobe? We have a C-shaped structure in the medial hemispheric surface, which is basically called as the limbic area, is what you have to fundamentally remember. Now, what are the components of the limbic system, doctor? This used to be a short answer question in MBBS and also as a clinician or more like a psychiatrist, you need to know, because our emotions, hunger, appetite, libido, sexual taste, everything is being basically controlled by the limbic system. So, what is the part of limbic system? We have a cingulate gyrus, parahippocampal gyrus, hippocampal formation, hippocampus, subiculum, dentate gyrus, they are all the part of it. Whatever that I have underlined in the notes, made it bold, just those words you remember. All you need not remember. What are the components of the limbic system? So, cingulate gyrus, parahippocampal gyrus, hippocampal formation is what need to be fundamentally remembered as a part of the limbic system. Then finally, there are few olfactory structures which are there in the cerebral, the brain, which are typically found on the orbital surface of the brain. And we have an olfactory bulb, olfactory trigone, and anterior perforated substance and diagonal band of Broca. So these are all the part of the, how we are able to feel the taste and smell of the food, olfactory structures. Now, doctor, comes a very important area, which is called basal ganglia. So fundamentally, what are basal ganglia? It's a huge sea of white matter. In the middle of the sea, you have islands, which have the sand. So similarly, in the brain, assuming it is a big sea of white matter, you have few islands of gray matter, which are subcortical nuclei, which are called the basal ganglia. Now, what are all the basal ganglia, doctor? Everybody, even a small kid in medical college will know it. What is that? Caudate nucleus, putamen, globus pallidus and amygdala. But what is the challenge about basal ganglia? which I never liked in a neuroanatomy book. Terminology is very cruel terminology in basal ganglia. What is that? What is meant by striatum? What is meant by lentiform nucleus? Combinations will get different name. Right? Caudate nucleus plus putamen is called striatum. Globus pallidus plus putamen, if they form a party, then it is called as lentiform nucleus, is what I want to underscore to all of you. So you must know this terminology. Commonly asked questions are on simple things in Indian exams. Then coming to the lateral ventricles. Of course, you go to USMLE or Indian entrance, anything, concepts fundamentally are the same. So let's have a hold on that so that any exam we can crack. Lateral ventricles are typically ependymal-lined cavities in the cerebral hemisphere. They contain the CSF and choroid plexus. Why it is important to know whether they have choroid plexus or not? Choroid plexus is the place where the CSF is formed. What is the importance of choroid plexus? If you take one ventricle with the other ventricle, whatever the connecting canal is there, no? It doesn't contain choroid plexus. Only within ventricle you have choroid plexus. That too in not all locations. Hence it is important to know where is it located. So, in lateral ventricles which are CSF filled and they contain the choroid plexus. And both of them are connected with the next, after lateral ventricles you have third ventricle, right? So they are connected to the third ventricle by two interventricular foramina of Monroe. So Monroe connects lateral ventricle with the third ventricle, and there are two Monroes because there are two lateral ventricles. And they basically are separated. One side, other side. Both sides lateral ventricles are separated by septa pellucida. Now, let us talk about cerebral cortex. That's all the story of the basal ganglia. A general structure of basal ganglia. Once more in neurophysiology we will take up. What is a dopaminergic system? Direct pathway, indirect pathway in basal ganglia. All these are the important issues for the examiner. So in the cerebral cortex, what is this? You have a mantle of gray substance in cerebral cortex. It is being folded into gyri. Gyri are separated by sulci. And basically if you look at the white matter has some connecting fibers which are called commissures. So it has got cerebral commissures, and the white matter is due to that myelin which is there around the axons. So from the brain, there is instruction going to the brainstem. What is that part called? Corticobulbar fibers. From the brain, instruction is going to Andrew-Horn cells in the spinal cord. What is that called? Corticospinal tract. So, this corticospinal tract and corticobulbar pathway, both will be descending down the cerebral cortex and ultimately they will be reaching either spinal cord or brainstem. So, while they are traveling through, they form a band which is then called internal capsule. So white matter has got either commissures which are the connecting fibers, or it has got internal capsule. Now let us talk about cerebral commissures. What are they? Fundamentally, they are the ones which interconnect the cerebral hemispheres. We have this corpus callosum, which is the largest commissure in the brain. Lot of times question is asked, what type of fibers do you find in corpus callosum? It is the commissural fibers. Commissure means one part of the brain to the other, identical part within the brain. You call it as commissure. We have association fibers, etc., etc., but commissural fibers in corpus callosum. Then, it has got one rostrum, one genu, one body, one splenium. Human beings, no, we are all. Anything we imagine, it like when we look at cloud also, we think it has got a head, it has got a tail. So similar imagination we will have everywhere. Hence these words. Genu, body, splenium, rostrum, etc. have come up. But whatever it is, you need to know, largest commissure in the body. If that is a question, what is your answer? It is the corpus callosum is what you need to remember. Then you have one more commissure, which is called as anterior commissure. What is its function basically? Typically, you have the olfactory bulbs. It will be interconnecting the olfactory bulbs and the middle and inferior temporal lobe. So that is the function of the anterior commissure. And we have one more commissure which is called hippocampal commissure. But generally you need to remember the main commissure which is the corpus callosum. Anterior commissure and hippocampal commissure. Mainly anterior commissure because of the olfactory bulbs and temporal lobes. Why? Temporal lobes have limbic system. And smell has a great influence on the limbic activity. So that's the reason we need an anterior commissure basically. Now, internal capsule. Every minute in the world, one or the other keeps getting stroke. Every minute, a confident human being across the globe will be becoming hemiplegic. Where is that spurt of the bleed happening into? It is happening into internal capsule. Stroke is nothing but a bleed which is happening into the internal capsule. So what is internal capsule? Internal capsule is basically that white matter. It's condensation of the white matter. Typically it is located between the basal ganglia, which are the strips of the gray matter, and the thalamus. Between the two it is located. So accordingly, any bleed which happens is broadly divided into two types of bleed in stroke. One is called capsuloganglionic bleed, where the bleed happened into internal capsule and the surrounding basal ganglia. Or it can be, the other type is thalamic bleed, where it has happened into the thalamus. How will you recognize it? If you take a CT scan, thalamic bleeds are horizontally oblong. How will you draw T? Downstroke? Horizontal stroke, no? So, thalamic bleeds by very nature when you look in a CT scan are horizontally oblong. Capsuloganglionic are vertically oblong. But overall, it is the most important location for the bleeding. Now, doctor, what is the structure of internal capsule? It has one anterior limb. And it has got a posterior limb and a genu. What about this anterior limb? Typically we said, no, internal capsule is located between thalamus and basal ganglia. So, this is the area where you have the caudate nucleus and putamen. Between the two, the anterior limb of the internal capsule is located. Okay, doc? So this is how typically from the brain the cortico-spinal pathway, pyramidal tract we call, no? It will be merging and passing through the internal capsule and descending down and will be reaching the anterior horn cells in the spinal cord. Similarly, cortico-bulbar fibers which are destined to reach the cranium nuclei in the brainstem, they will also pass through the internal capsule. So this is the point of interest which you need to understand. So any bleed here will interrupt this transmission and hence persons will get hemiplegia. So the genu, what does it contain? There's a somatotopic distribution of fibers within the internal capsule. In the genu, you have all the fibers going to cortico-bulbar part. Whereas in the posterior limb, you have all the fibers which are going to the become corticospinal fibers, right? So this is the somatotopic distribution of the fibers within the internal capsule. So summarize, doctor, it has an anterior limb located between the caudate nucleus and putamen. It has got a genu and which has got corticobulbar fibers, and you have posterior limb in the internal capsule which has got cortico spinal fibers is what I want to underscore to all of you. So this is all the story, doctor, about telencephalon, the main part of the cerebral hemispheres. Then what is diencephalon? Typically, that part of the brain which is there between the interventricular foramen, between the two lateral ventricles, and the posterior commissure is called diencephalon. What will diencephalon mainly will be doing? It will be receiving the optic nerve, and it consists of epithalamus, thalamus, hypothalamus, subthalamus, and third ventricle. All these structures put together are basically called as diencephalon. After that, what do you have? You have the midbrain, uppermost part of the brainstem. So, before we go to midbrain, let us dissect through the diencephalon. Typically in diencephalon, what do you have? First, epithalamus. You have epithalamus, thalamus, hypothalamus, subthalamus. Right? It looks like aloo curry, aloo chutney, aloo sambar, all aloo finally rotating around thalamus. So epithalamus, thalamus, hypothalamus, subthalamus and third ventricle, they are all the part of the diencephalon. Now what is the part of epithalamus? You heard of pineal body, right? So pineal body, posterior commissure, they are the only things that you can remember. Remaining things you will forget and don't remember also. Right? Let them remain in notes forever. So you must be sure what should be transferred from the textbook into notes, from notes into the brain and from brain into eternity. So you must be quite sure. So but pineal body, posterior commissure are the part of the epithalamus. What is the importance of posterior commissure? Posterior commissure is very important. When you throw light into one eye, while it is passing, it has to pass through optic nerve, optic chiasma, and optic tract. So posterior commissure is the one which basically mediates the consensual reaction in a pupillary light reaction. So that's the only reason we need to remember. Anyway, we will, if it has got significance, we will decide it in the neurophysiology. For now, you know it is a part of the epithalamus. Then comes the thalamus. Why thalamus is called thalamus? Bedroom it is. All sensory system will go to thalamus. All secrets happen in bedroom. If they are open and out, then they become news. So, all sensory pathways ultimately will merge onto thalamus, and thalamus is the relay station for all the sensation to the sensory cortex. So that is the reason we need to basically remember. So what are the important parts of thalamus? Thalamus has got a very big structure which is called pulvina. One of the common questions asked is, out of all the component structures, you have metathalamus, hypothalamus, infundibulum, tuberous inarium, all these things. So pulvinar is very prominent. Then we have metathalamus. Metathalamus has got two important bodies. Medial geniculate body, lateral geniculate body, we have studied it now in ENT ophthalmology. All ENT is about what? Medial geniculate body. All ophthalmology is about lateral geniculate body. What is the paradox? Eyes are medial, but it is a lateral geniculate body. Ears are lateral, but it is a medial geniculate body. But you need to ultimately remember whatever it is. So it is a part of thalamus. Then we have a hypothalamus after thalamus, which contains optic chiasma, mammillary body, tuberous inarium, infundibulum. These are all the part of the hypothalamus. Then we have a subthalamus. Subthalamus contains a very, very important basal ganglia which is called subthalamic nucleus. What do you get if there is any lesion in the subthalamic nucleus, doctor? This is the typical area where the subthalamic nucleus is located. You get hemiballismus, like a bat with a winging movement, your hand will be winging if you get a subthalamic nucleus lesion, which is called hemiballismus. So, subthalamic nucleus is a part of ventral thalamus, which is also called subthalamus. And third ventricle also is very closely related with the ventral thalamus. Now, doctor, if you look embryologically, there is a lamina terminalis. Basically, our nervous system is formed like a tube. So, a tube will have two pores, one anterior neuropore, one posterior neuropore. So, the lamina terminalis basically will occur due to the closure of the anterior neuropore, which is also the part of the entire system which we are talking in diencephalon. Then, what is meant by interventricular foramen of Mohndra? The lateral ventricles are communicating with the third ventricles with this interventricular foramen of Mohndra is what you have to fundamentally remember. Now, doctor, let us talk about the next part of the division of the brain. So, what did you finish till now? Telencephalon, diencephalon. In the diencephalon, what will you remember? All forms of thalamic. Hypo, epi, there is no para, right? So, thalamus and subthalamus, right? Now, midbrain. Basically, what does midbrain contain? It contains cerebral aqueduct. Now tell me, doctor, which ventricles are there in the telencephalon? Lateral ventricles. Which ventricle is there in diencephalon? Third ventricle. Then third ventricle connects with fourth ventricle, no? I will tell you later where is fourth ventricle located, but for now. What is that connecting link called as? The cerebral aqueduct. That connecting link is the one which is there in the midbrain. So, mesencephalon basically contains cerebral aqueduct. Basically, doctor, whenever we talk brainstem is like a heart. Heart-like structure. It has an anterior surface, posterior surface. So, every part of the brainstem, whether it is midbrain or pons or medulla, we talk about what are the structures, aage kya hai, piche kya hai. Anterior structures are what, posterior structures are what. So now let us talk about the ventral surface of the midbrain. It contains cerebral peduncle, between the two peduncles one intrapeduncular fossa. And it also has oculomotor nerve nucleus. We said no, third and fourth come from midbrain. Then it has posterior perforated substance. What is this posterior perforated substance? You have the posterior cerebral and posterior communicating arteries, which are the part of the vertebrobasilar system. So they typically form penetrating branches, which typically form what is called posterior perforated substance. But what is the sad part about it? It is called posterior perforated substance, but it is located on ventral surface, not dorsal surface. Whatever. Now, a very common question. Forget about exam. Once we get into playing the game of neuroanatomy, we should think that we are going to use all this in the neurology rounds. Still, don't worry, I made it purely exam oriented and removed all unnecessary stuff from the textbook and tried to bring it as small as possible still to not lose the important things. But this is something which you should not forget, doctor. Cut section of rostral part, caudal part, rostral part, caudal part of each of the three components of brainstem. At the end of neuroanatomy class, you must be in a position to draw a sketch and tell these are the structures in the rostral part, caudal part of each of the three components of the brainstem. Now, let us look into it. This is the rostral part of the midbrain. I have cut it and looking at it. What will I find? There is the area which is the area where our eye movements are controlled, superior colliculus. Vision associated part is superior colliculus. You have a tectum which is the roof. You have a tegmentum which is the floor. That are the two parts. Then as we have rightly said, cerebral aqueduct is the main orifice which you will find in the middle of midbrain. Then what else do you have? You have substantia nigra, cerebral peduncles. Then of course every part of the brainstem you will find these two brothers. Who are they? One corticospinal, who want to go all the way to Kanyakumari, and corticobulbar, who want to get down of the AP Express at Bhopal, because bulbar fibers are only until central part of India. Spinal fibers will reach until Kanyakumari. Chennai Express they need to catch. So both of them will be there in every station. If you check what are there, corticospinal and corticobulbar fibers are typically present. Then very important structure in the cut section is, in the rostral part of the midbrain, is red nucleus. Why it is important? Our movement of the body is controlled by four things, doctor. What are they? Brain plans. After planning, it doesn't do anything. It is like the father in the family, only producing children. It doesn't know how to bring them up. So who is the mother who will plan it? Cerebellum. It will be checking, will this child got fever, that child is not eating well, this child is reading or not. All those things it will check. Of course, there are fathers who are like that and mothers who are callous. But generally, taking the biological nature of the world, cerebellum decides. Then in every home, there is a mama who influences the family. Mother's brother. He is a strong person. He will bring gifts. He will remember your birthday even if the father forgets. The producer. So, mama is basal ganglia. Right? Then in every home there is one critic who compares her children with us. Who is that? Father's sister. So she says that my children are only intelligent, your children are not intelligent. Continuously. So, we get a seat in MD or anything only to prove to our cousins that yeah, we are very good. So compared to them. So that's the reason your red nucleus is that paternal aunt who is the strong critic. To impress her, we will do everything. Of course, if she has got a daughter, things become altogether complicated. So finally you need to impress not only paternal aunt, but red nucleus, even the red nucleus, rubro, cerebellar fibers also. So doctor, summarize, red nucleus is very important. That's the reason if the red nucleus has a lesion, what will happen? There will be a rubral tremor which will create. What is that syndrome called as? Benedict syndrome. How will you not forget? Benedict solution we do know, just remember. Mannu is our director for mnemonics, but Benedict syndrome is something to do with glucose test. In that red color means glucose is there. So red nucleus, Benedict syndrome, rubral tremor, one of the important structures. So where do you find this red nucleus, doctor? We find it in the midbrain. Then, this is the caudal part of the midbrain. Here you have inferior colliculus and the other oculomotor nerve nucleus which is there is fourth, trochlear, right? Then cerebral aqueduct as usually continues. We have got the substantia nigra which is present. Then these are the various structures. Okay, now what are the structures on the dorsal surface of the midbrain? Ventral surface, oculomotor nerve nucleus is over. Story. Now, we have superior colliculus important for the visual system. It is a part of, it is sitting on the back of the midbrain, dorsal surface. Then there is a inferior colliculus which is also located on the dorsal surface only, not ventral. Then we have trochlear nerve, which is there on the dorsal surface. So what is the rule about it? The only cranial nerve to exit from the dorsal aspect of the brainstem is the trochlear nerve. You are not going to basically forget. Then comes the pons. Once more, pons, same story. Ventral surface, dorsal surface, what structures are located in that? If you know this, you know neuroanatomy. No big deal. In the ventral surface, you have trigeminal nerve, 5th, abducens nerve, 6th, facial nerve, 7th, vestibular cochlear, 8th. So these are all the things located. Of course, facial nerve is there almost at the pontomedullary junction. Vestibular cochlear is altogether pontomedullary junction. And hence 7th and 8th will be exiting out, and they will be, they are the typical nerves which are in a vulnerability to get compressed by cerebellopontine tumors. Now that is the story of ventral surface. But on the dorsal surface of the pons, pons kib, we are talking about the back of the pons, you have a fossa which is called rhomboid fossa. So what are the structures in this rhomboid fossa? You have locus ceruleus. This is one of the favorite questions of the examiner. Examiner don't ask miraculous questions, simple things. Where is locus ceruleus located? You should be able to remember it is there in pons. Of course, to help you out, he will give a wide opportunity. Is it present in the knee joint or in the pelvis, or is it there in the brain? If so, then in pons. So, pons, right? Then, you have a facial colliculus which contains the abducens nucleus and the internal genu of the facial nerve. And you have a sulcus limitans and the striae medullaris of the rhomboid fossa. These are all the structures which are located on the dorsal surface. Mainly you need to remember facial colliculus, locus ceruleus, sulcus limitans. These are the three buzzwords about rhomboid fossa contents. Then comes the medulla. Once more, ventral dorsal. In the ventral surface, what do you have, doctor? Your corticospinal tract is descending down, no? So it is coming in the same direction. By the time it reaches medulla, it decussates. So whenever it is decussating, typically it will be forming pyramid. Right? So the pyramid which contains corticospinal tract. Then there is one beautiful structure in the medulla which you should not forget. We said cerebellum is mother. So somebody should tell mother about what is the father's plan. So inferior olivary nucleus in the medulla will be continuously talking to the mom. It is a telephone our brainstem is having. You'll be telling that movements are going this way, spinal cord is telling like this, everything, the information is going through the medulla, no? So that is informed by the inferior olivary nucleus to the cerebellum. So you have a cerebello olivary cerebro, a tract which is connecting all the three through and through. So inferior olivary nucleus is an important structure to be remembered on the ventral surface of the medulla. Right, doctor? Then you, what cranial nerves do you have? All the remaining cranial nerves are in medulla. Glossopharyngeal, vagal, accessory, hypoglossal, everything else is there in the medulla. They are all located in the ventral surface. Then, what is there on the dorsal surface? Medulla ke piche kya hai? What is creeping on the back of it? Typically, you have gracile and cuneate nucleus which are bringing the dorsal column sensations. Vibration, position, touch, not temperature pain. So they are all reaching the medulla, and typically you have gracile and cuneate tubercle. Even the dorsal surface of the medulla also has one rhomboid fossa, where you have vagal trigone, hypoglossal trigone, sulcus limitans. But very important structure on the medulla's dorsal surface in its rhomboid fossa is area proxima, is what need to be remembered, which is the vomiting center in our body. Right, doctor? So that's all the story of how the brain, when you cut, looks like ventral and dorsal surface. Then let us talk about cerebellum. Cerebellum is located in the posterior cranial fossa, right? And cerebellum connects to the brainstem by throwing three ropes. Cerebellum is a small brain, you have a brainstem. So it will throw three ropes and hangs to the cerebellum. What are they called? Peduncles. Cerebellar peduncles. So it is attached to the brainstem by three cerebellar peduncles, and cerebellum forms the roof of the fourth ventricle, and it is separated from the telencephalon. Which part of the telencephalon? Occipital lobe and temporal lobe of the brain are there, no? It is separated from them by what is called tentorium cerebelli, is what need to be remembered. And basically, cerebellum means leaves. It contains leaves. Structure, if you look, folia. So, how will you recognize a cerebellar atrophy? There are some congenital neurological disorders where there is a olivocerebellar atrophies. If you look at an MRI, look at the cerebellum, normally it does not throw excessive folds. If the folds are too many, too excessive, folia are there. That means cerebellum has got degenerated. So that's how we recognize by prominence of the cerebellar folia, the presence of a cerebellar degeneration. Now what does cerebellum contain? It also has hemispheres which are made up of two lateral lobes, one midline structure called vermis. There is a cerebellar tonsil which can herniate through foramen magnum if there is a raised intracranial tension. Then there is a superior cerebellar peduncle. What does it basically connect? Cerebellum to the pons and midbrain is superior cerebellar peduncle. Middle cerebellar peduncle, cerebellum to the pons. Inferior cerebellar peduncle, cerebellum to the medulla, the lowest structure. Otherwise, you can remember inferior is medulla, middle is pons, superior is midbrain, but also with pons. Once more, in neurophysiology, we will discuss which brings afferents and also efferents to the cerebellum, which brings only, which takes only efferents. All those things we will boil down when we discuss neurophysiology. Now, doctor, we have one anterior lobe, we have one posterior lobe, and one flocculo nodular lobe. These are all the parts of the cerebellum. So this completes our review on gross anatomy of the brain.